Lesley Riddock is a veteran journalist and broadcaster who's in Belfast to take part in a conference organised by Development Trust NI, looking at the theme of community ownership as a movement for social change. Lesley, just first of all, thank you very much for joining us today in the studio.
No, you're fine.
Just to begin, you know, as part of the conference, you're going to be talking about the Scottish experience of this concept of community ownership. And I think that, you know, when we think about Scotland and this concept of community ownership, I think a lot of people think of Egg Island and that famous case back in the 90s where the community itself went and bought the island for themselves. Can you tell us a bit about what actually happened there 20 years ago on that island?
Yeah, well, it's celebrating its 21st birthday this year, actually. And this was before the Scottish Parliament, before land reform legislation, before anything. So basically, these were islanders doing it for themselves completely without any political or government support. It's a little island. It's beautiful. It's in the Inner Hebrides. And it was owned for hundreds of years by private landowners who tended to be absentees. It sort of came to a head with the last but one landowner, Keith Schellenberg, who just wasn't there a lot, didn't issue leases. People couldn't get housing improvement grants, really basic things, because they didn't have a lease just. The houses were awful. There was old people living in one room of an old cottage with cold water only and with kind of stones holding down the skylights, those old fashioned ones that had the round bits. You wouldn't believe what you were seeing when you went around in the 1990s. So slowly the islanders began to realise that there was only one other alternative for them, which was to try and go for a buyout. Now here, speaking from the vantage of this year, looking back, that looks inevitable. Mm. At the time, it just wasn't, because everyone, even though the landowner wasn't there, felt very beholden to him. He also employed some people, and that meant they were a bit separate from the rest of the community. And it really took extraordinary moments where he issued an eviction notice on a family of six at Christmas. That galvanised people, and he stopped the farm tractor being used to deliver diesel to old people, which would mean they would have frozen that winter. And that basically meant all the staff resigned. They joined the buyout team. That pushed it forward. It still took 8 years, eight long years, to get to the point of putting up a public request for money. I was there on the island as a trustee. I was a trustee for 8 years because they chose off-island people to be trustees in case if they stood, they were evicted for just joining a development trust. That's how bad it was. And when I was there when the post bag would come in and there would be pound notes sent from wee lads in Govan, there would be fivers from grannies in Edinburgh. It would break your heart actually to see how much the individuals of Britain actually completely supported the buyout because they could see it was very justified. And on the 12th of June 1997, the big handover finally happened and the islanders had bought their island.
And it is amazing that, you know, when you look back, and it is the days before the likes of crowdfunding, but I mean, in their case, they were able to generate a lot of support that way. I mean, as you say, people giving, donating the pounds and the fivers and so on. I mean, was it something maybe that even they were expecting in terms of that level of interest or the level of people willing to get behind the kind of proposal or the initiative that
No, I think nobody had any idea that there would be so much support. But of course, within Scotland, that story of the clearances is still sitting within our psyche. And when you see islanders, they became the first islanders in history to buy their island back from a laird. Now just take that sentence, that's powerful. Mm-hmm. So a lot of people were quick to support it. They raised £1.56 million without a penny from the government. A large donation was made by a wealthy woman from the north of England, but the bulk of it really was individual donations. And some of it, at the time, I was actually deputy editor of The Scotsman. So let's say that the story got probably more than its fair share of coverage. But luck is a large part of these things. You get opportunities and moments. And the successful buyouts are the ones that have just grabbed opportunities. And they're often related to difficulties, because difficulties unite people. And they give you a focus, a timescale, and a kind of urge to unite, which it can be hard to maintain for other community groups that are more sort of diffuse than that.
And on that, I mean, when they did eventually buy over the island, I mean, the set to work, I suppose, you know, coming together to preserve it, to maintain it as it was. I mean, there was the likes of the Egg Building Collective and so on developed. I mean, can you tell us a bit about that there, how they came together, I suppose, in that kind of collective action to sort of say, okay, we're going to look after ourselves as a community together here?
Well, probably the eight long years had its benefit, because it meant people really had to work and stick together and talk to one another a lot. So they'd also had a huge problem with heating. everybody had these diesel generators, and that was their first ambition, was to get rid of that because it was expensive, polluting and hard to move around. So they applied for grants, got them, and set up Eggtricity, which is an off-grid scheme that's now won awards and has people arriving from all over the world. It's got hydro, obviously, it's a Hebridean island. It's got solar and wind, and the three of them together provide a little network. Everyone on Egg has had to agree that their homes will only use 5 kilowatts, and if they use more than that, they trip their house and have to pay 50 quid to be reconnected. No one has yet done that. And that is achieved by having a meter on your table. So if you put something on, like a washing machine, you have to switch everything else off. And actually, the Egg Building Collective that was set up to do all the repairs that had been waiting for simply leases to be issued, these guys have developed an island style of home, which actually doesn't have a utility room because they're fitting in with the low energy use of the island. And they have become experts at building good homes for islands. They've also got to, self-building is actually very popular. People are using wood from the island, which before was thought to be not dense enough to use well, but they've learnt how to use that. You just have thicker beams. And that means, probably this is the greatest achievement of Egg, is that they're offering land for free to young people to build their own homes. If that way, when you take land out of the equation, you can build a two-bedroomed house for £40,000. Now, if anybody watching this can think of anywhere in the British Isles where you can do that, I'd love to hear about it.
I suppose, what would you say then it's meant for the island over the past 20 years? I mean, we talk about those examples, but because I think it's fair to say, you know, the general theme or the general conversation, you know, like around kind of people living on islands and the Highlands, for example, even in, you know, the west coast of Ireland, I mean, you hear about it, just the difficulty of life and how it's in some ways unsustainable to keep populations in some of these places. What do you think the kind of community ownership of Egg has meant for the community there and maybe its resilience and, you know, looking into the future as well?
That probably is the biggest achievement, actually, is that these guys now think they can do anything. And they're the same people. They're the same people who actually were too scared to be trustees just 25 years ago. But now they are running several companies. They're pioneers in practically every aspect of what they're doing. In just small things, they take very different types of decisions. I remember when the first house became available that they owned to allocate to someone, the normal allocations policy would have put it either to a young man who had a job, he was a farmer there, or an older lady who lived on the mainland, she was elderly. But they chose to give it to two 18-year-old friends, two girls, living together to share it, because actually all the evidence suggests that depopulation happens when women leave, not men, and that jobs, usually investment goes into agriculture, fish farming, these kind of things. It stabilizes men's lives, and women are just the ones who are peeling away. So without even having read that report, they intuitively did the right thing. And those two women are now living there with bairns, with a family, and that is helping to stabilise the population.
Look more broadly, I mean, there are other examples, you know, the likes of, you know, Story Sue East and the Noidert Foundation, for example. I mean, it seems that in the Highlands and the Islands, I mean, it's something that did start to catch on in communities.
Well, what happened was that, as I say, Egg did this without any help in 1997. A Scottish Parliament started in 1999. I think fairly full of guilt, actually, about the fact that these guys had to do all of it themselves. And before them, other crofters in Assent had also done a buyout on their own. And they were aware that land reform in Scotland is a scandal. We were waiting for some of the land reform legislation that actually happened in Ireland in the 1900s. It never happened because of the First World War. So we have a situation where 432 people own half the private land of Scotland. One duke owns 1% of the landmass. That is weird. So everyone realised when the Scottish Parliament started, this was overdue being dealt with. So land reform legislation came in, and that allowed communities to buy out bits of land. The people who went for it were all the islanders. The Western Isles particularly went with it. Storis Uist, as you mentioned there, which is Benbecula and parts of South Uist. But actually smaller buyouts have occurred right up that island chain. But it never really moved further inland than that. And there's a thing to say about that, because actually you can't solve the problem of unequal land distribution by buying out a couple of acres at a time. There isn't the money in Christendom to do that. So really, a lot of us feel, land reformers, feel that the Scottish Government is relying on communities to do the heavy lifting, and it is really heavy lifting to do a land buyout, that it won't do by introducing some sort of land tax or putting some more radical land reform in to free up more land everywhere.
What was the reaction then of landlords? You know, like for example, in the egg example, you know, that idea of the community coming to buy the land out, that as you say, there were, you know, difficulties, there were some conflict, you know, between the people living there and this absentee landlord. So what was the reaction then, you know, from the likes of this lord when it comes to community saying, well, actually, we want to buy you out here?
Well, back in the egg days, Keith Schellenberg was furious. Basically, Schellenberg was insulted by the community wanting to leave what he hoped was their father. There's odd dynamics in a lot of these communities where landowners really think they're a father figure for their children. When it becomes apparent that isn't the way that the locals look at it, they're not children, folk can feel very hurt. And he certainly felt very hurt about it.
I want to ask about an article you wrote recently. You know, there's a particular community in Ardnamurchan who went to the stage where the community is building its own schools. It's taken these steps further and further that even something that I suppose technically should have been maybe government sort of business, you know, that the community are doing for themselves as well.
Aye, this is an extraordinary one, and it would be right to say that the other big sustaining things behind this, which I don't think are true in Northern Ireland, is that first of all there was that land reform legislation for buyouts. Then there was a fund put in with millions of pounds to be able to apply for, to be able to do those buyouts and to help you with your business plan to get you up and running, because otherwise they could well have failed. And the next thing was actually community hydro. Now, obviously, Scotland's got a lot more potential for hydro than Northern Ireland, but communities really seized on this and put in applications for community hydro, sold community shares, and then found themselves, and of course, wind farms. That came beforehand. So these community energy projects really began to bulk up people's capacity and gave them a steady income. And then the UK government axed it last year. So Strontian in Ardnamurchan were the last folk in who managed to get a community hydro. That's given them, I think it's about £1 million since then to use on local community stuff. But it also began to get them feeling a bit more sort of oomphy about what they could take on. So their primary school was going to close because it was old, it didn't have the right play space requirements, all sorts of stuff. It wasn't going to be closed completely. The object was to merge it with the local secondary school. But because it was a PFI school, you can't touch on any aspect of it until the contract's finished. So it would take 10 years before they could have built on the primary to the side. And what the Highland Council had proposed in the meantime was porta-cabins, the dreaded porta-cabins. So the community looked at it and thought, you know, that doesn't help anyone. So what they did was, I mean, extraordinarily cunning, really. They used their land buyout powers to be able to buy some land, you know, fairly close, actually, to the secondary school. They then persuaded Highland Council and got money from elsewhere to build effectively 4 affordable connected homes on it. And in the meantime, that will be a school and it opens next week. So if the plan A goes ahead and the new primary is built beside the secondary, then the community has got 4 affordable homes in a really remote area out of it, instead of seeing a bunch of porta cabins that then waltz off back somewhere else at the end of everything. And if it doesn't ever come off, they've still got a proper primary school that can cope with all the kids.
Is this an idea, you know, community ownership more generally, is an idea that's maybe started to sort of slip into the rest of Scotland? Hasn't that maybe the public consciousness in terms, not necessarily in terms of owning land, but, you know, like for example, you know, buildings or these different types of resources in the community? Did you think in some ways it has started to slip into maybe the national consciousness in Scotland at all?
It totally has. There has been a community empowerment bill passed which allows the transfer of public assets. It should be fairly hassle-free. It's not working out like that. Councils are tending to hang on to things, or they only want to transfer the things that are real turkeys. And communities have to watch that they're not trying to take on something which has got reasons for not being used or has got huge on costs to maintain. But sure, there are communities taking on parks. That's very popular. There's everything been going on from people buying out bridges, which are used to just connect up kind of areas that used to have huge long detours to reach one another. And there's buildings, libraries, all sorts of things. There's even doctors' surgeries. There's all sorts of things like that. But the question out of the end of that is this the thing that's appropriate for unfunded community groups to be doing? These are core government functions. And I would have thought that when you start to get to the stage where some areas, particularly those who've got wind income, that's massive amounts of income with low populations, are thinking about doing things like providing old folks homes, and that's true on the Western Isles, you've really got to ask, why are they paying a council tax? Because they're beginning to run practically some of the core things that you pay a council tax for. I do a lot of work in Norway, and when you start to look at those countries and you look actually at the whole of Europe, what you see is that all small towns everywhere have powerful councils, and they have structure, they have predictable income, they have democracy, and that is what keeps most stuff on the road. It's almost like we're having to double dunt in Britain because we have such large remote councils that the community has to come in and knit those abstract things to the ground where they live. And I wonder whether that is a long-term recipe for success.
If we look at the initiatives of the Scottish Government, you know, since devolution, it's something I think it's fair to say it started under Labour, but it maybe went into overdrive under the SNP, that you did see the likes of the Community Empowerment Act of, I think it was 2015, Land Reform Act was 2016. When these kinds of bills are coming through, what would you say has been the reaction from, so it's not necessarily vested interest, but I mean the likes of, for example, landlords, I mean even the government, so it was Westminster, to the moves that the Scottish Government's making to sort of support communities in these different ways?
The Westminster government isn't, that's the least of their worries about Scotland. So they're not even remotely interested as far as I can see. Landowners, they have slightly changed their tune. They were very obstructive at the beginning. Since they've begun to see that the tide might be turning, they've made some efforts to dump the people who look more obstructive, and they have actually voluntarily handed over some areas. They're kind of cute enough to hand over land which is already subject to crofting, so that means actually they had very little control over it anyway. But for example, everyone might have heard of the Duke of Sutherland, who was one of the principal architects of the clearances. So the new Duke of Sutherland has handed over quite a substantial bit of his estate to the local people in Helmsdale. Of course, it's all in crofting, so he couldn't have done anything with it anyway. But in principle, it's showing the beginnings that modern lairds can see. They don't want to be saddled with the resentment, the responsibility, and the guilt that goes with the massive ownership of bits of land where they are totally stagnating their communities. But still, there's examples. The Duke of Buccleuch has recently been evicting tenants to get cash to plant trees. Mm. Now, that's all under Scottish Government legislation because they've got targets to reforest Scotland. And if you don't sort land reform out first, every government initiative has to put money into the hands of the existing landowners, and it therefore sort of bolsters that setup.
Given the Scottish Government is creating, you know, sort of gauge, if you like, in terms of, you know, this is your right to buy, for example, this is, you know, what asset transfer means. I mean, there are funds, as you mentioned, sort of being created. You know, even though there might be issues around, I mean, would it be fair to say that the Scottish Government is serious with this idea of community ownership?
It's very serious about community ownership. I mean, regularly there are people coming from all over the world to look at different aspects. I mean, there's practically nothing in Scotland that hasn't got a community owning it. It really is now getting quite extraordinary. And of course, because that does look like it's the plucky little people. I mean, nobody anywhere in the world has got a problem with a story that's based on plucky little people fighting for the community. But you've still got to ask, why do you have to pluck your community out of a system that remains unchanged? So I hear what you're saying. Compared to Northern Ireland, the Scots are laughing. But we're laughing in a context that actually we're beginning to outgrow. And as Scotland is beginning to look, particularly to the Nordic countries, for new models about how you might want to run a nation of 5 million people, whether it's highly devolved or independent, you begin to see that nobody else has community buyouts because they have proper systems and they have very small councils.
And as I understand as well, I mean, to go back to the issues mostly of the landlords, The Scottish government, was, I think it was last year, announced a Scottish Land Commission. I mean, I imagine the idea is to look at, okay, what is the state, the ownership of the land in Scotland, and maybe from then maybe start doing something about it.
Yes, and that was very important. A lot of us were campaigning on that, and actually, we were campaigning for some of the rights that Ireland, including Northern Ireland, got back with the Windham Act in 1903, when tenant farmers here got the right to buy. It was a huge, huge thing for Ireland, and it changed the face of Ireland. That same legislation was going to come into Scotland, but the First World War got in the way. So we still have tenant farmers who are being chucked off the land fairly arbitrarily. So that was a push we had to try to change that and adopt the Irish regulations, which the Scottish government rejected. So in the wake of that, yes, there was a Scottish Land Commission set up, which was going to revisit these issues because they were seen as being too tricky to get through quickly. So they've been looking at a land value tax, a tenant's right to buy, and all sorts of other things that are alarming to landowners. If you read the Daily Telegraph on a regular basis, which I don't, you will see track the Scottish Land Commission's proposals in great depth because they're pretty worried about where it might be going. And for any radical or anyone who wants to see change in their lifetime, that's good.
I understand that there is also local democracy reform. It's just begun. I mean, it's underway. It's kind of whatever consultations are happening at the minute, but it's something that's been seriously looked at. You've mentioned some of the challenges that are coming from councils, and so is this something you're hoping to see might happen? There might be reform, for the betterment, for the empowerment of people and communities.
I know I seem like a real sort of damn. You know, the more you're trying to suggest Scotland's doing really well, and it is in many ways, the more I'm pouring cold water on it. But the local democracy bill is a disappointment, really, because what we actually need is to look again at the fact that we have the largest local councils in the developed world. The average size of a so-called local council in Scotland is 170,000 people. The average in the EU is 10. The average in Germany is 7,000. If we look at our cousins in Norway, we have the same population, 5.2 million. Scotland has 32 councils. Norway has 422. As a result, in Norway, 1 in 88 people stands for election. In Scotland, it's 1 in 2,071. Now, if we want to keep going like this, fine. But let's not pretend that the system works to empower people. I mean, we're doing pretty well despite a structure that no other European government would tolerate for a nanosecond. And yet there's not really any plans to give us town councils back, give us island councils back. So islands like Barra, for example, which is the closest of the Western Isles to Ireland, if you're a councillor in Barra, it takes you 3 days to get to your local headquarters of your council and back again. And a very good friend of mine who's a councillor there, who's been doing it for decades, is about to retire. Nobody else wants the job. Now, are they apathetic? Or is the council the wrong size? Mm. So really, there's a lot of us, including the Electoral Reform Society Scotland, who started up a campaign, Act As If You Own the Place, just a wee bit disruptive. And we've been setting up People's Council meetings all over Scotland to get communities together to say, if you were a council the size that you are, what would you put first in your own community? And that has created a bit of movement, but no political party is yet picking up and running with it. And of course, in Scotland, there are other constitutional issues that tend to be the biggest cleavage points in politics. So right now, I would say there is huge movement in the grassroots that is not filtering through to party politics. When there is some resolution one way or t'other of the constitutional issue, I think we could see quite dramatic change.
If we look at the issue of Brexit, I mean, one of the outcomes in terms of what the Westminster Parliament are doing right now, I mean, it seems that they're set on maybe removing some of the powers from the Scottish government, some of the devolved powers it was given. Especially when we look at that context of what potentially could happen to the Scottish Parliament, what do you think is the importance there of ensuring that as much power as possible goes to the people, that, that idea of community ownership from the bottom up is supported as much as possible while it can be done?
Well, sure, the sudden axing of all the community energy grants was a pretty good demonstrator of how difficult it is when energy is a reserved issue. And in lots of other devolved governments, they would be surprised to hear that energy is not devolved. Of course, in this case of Scotland, that would mean devolving oil, and that's a bit of a biggie. So that hasn't happened. But when you think about the other things, whether it is fishing or agricultural subsidies, then what communities can hope to get from land if they buy it is not so clear. And overall, the economy of Scotland, which has to produce a bit of cash to put these funds up, will shrink. And there is no predictor of Brexit, no shape of Brexit that promises larger government coffers than we have at the moment. They're all going to get smaller. So really, the wee guys, the guys at the margins, the ones last in, are usually first out. And it would be extraordinary if we could keep up the level of funding post-Brexit that we have at the moment.
I know that the question of independence never went away after the 2014 referendum. There was always a chance in the background that there could, eventually be another one. But do you think Brexit has the potential of giving, the independence movement a boost again and maybe putting it back on the top of the political agenda?
Well, I have to say, as somebody who spends every waking moment, it feels like, going round groups all over Scotland who have never stopped campaigning since 2014, the idea that independence is coming back is a strange one. The way the media works, it likes one big event somewhere, and lots of small events everywhere don't get covered. And obviously, the SNP has been wary of nailing its colours to the mast, because then it gets accused of not doing the day job. So we're in a kind of long cat and mouse standoff at the moment, where I think all independent supporters will find it very difficult if there isn't a move towards a second referendum soon around Brexit. But they're quite prepared to cut Nicola Sturgeon some slack about exactly when she calls it. I think at the moment, a lot of people are thinking that the Tory party might well implode, and timing, well, it's important. So it might be that in the wake of that, perhaps with Boris Johnson as a prime minister and Jacob Rees-Mogg as a chief secretary to the Treasury, that looks like the kind of lineup that would scare the bejesus out of anybody. So, there could be a move to wait for then. But I think that there will be a push to have something in this Brexit period, unless, of course, through some miracle, it all goes away.
Just to wrap up, so to look a bit beyond these islands, you've spoken a bit about the Nordic countries, and you've done a lot of work there. You visited and been doing research in them. If there's maybe one takeaway from the likes of Norway, for example, or any of these countries, Iceland, the Faroe Islands, whatever it may be, do you think the takeaway, is it about fundamentally about democracy, about the sort of trust of local people putting that power, I suppose, as close to the ground as possible? Do you think that's maybe the main takeaway that you've got from your work in these countries?
It totally is. And I mean, a lot of times people, when you tell them that, that's not what they want to hear. They want to hear something about oil funds or something special or something exotic. And it's boring to hear that the world's most equal societies with the best functioning democracies, almost 100% literacy, they're tediously at the top of every blasted league table you could ever come up with. Their secret is not a secret. It is that they have got the most local control on earth. And as a result of that and other things, they have a very equal society. That's the other point. Even conservative governments talk about solidarity and equality, and they aim to have the smallest possible income gap. The United Kingdom has the largest income gap in the OECD. So the two things, equality and total local control, those things together have really been the fundaments for the Nordic model. And then everything else gets placed on top of that. So that's the thing that characterises them, and we should really learn.
Well, Lesley, once again, thank you very much for joining us today for this conversation.
Oh, you're fine. Thanks.